Welcome to the Hazardous Materials module, in which we will discuss basic concepts in protecting ourselves, scene management, and general concerns as they relate to hazardous materials. Please be aware that a hazardous materials incident could encompass any number or combination of chemicals, and this module is not designed to teach hazardous materials mitigation at any level. The information contained within the presentation is awareness level material only. Once completed with this module, you should be able to explain the EMT's role during a call involving hazardous materials. Describe what the EMT should do if there is reason to believe that there is a hazard at the scene. Describe the actions that an EMT should take to ensure bystander safety. State the role the EMT should perform until appropriately trained personnel arrive on scene. Break down the steps to approaching a hazardous materials situation, and discuss various environmental hazards that affect EMS. Hazardous materials can be found everywhere. They are shipped around the world every day on trucks, airplanes, ships, and rail cars. The average household has numerous chemical agents used for cleaning and other household needs. They are so common that it is really just a matter of time before you will encounter a hazardous materials incident. Even though the transportation of hazardous materials is highly regulated, the actual extent of these materials moved across our communities on a regular basis is unknown because placarding is required only when the materials being transported reach a certain threshold amount. With this in mind, safety must always remain in the EMT's primary concern. Safety for our crews, patients, and the general public requires us to slow down our approach to hazardous materials scenes and identify crucial visual indicators. Anytime an EMS crew is dispatched to a call with a potential hazardous materials spill or leak, it is imperative to slow down once the scene is in sight to avoid entering a dangerous environment. It is important to observe the scene for clues that will assist the response, keep the EMS crew safe, and help with the determination as to whether or not additional resources are necessary. The EMS crew first needs to recognize that a hazardous materials problem exists. Once that is established, the first responding EMS crew must attempt to control the scene while also identifying the substance if possible. First, the EMT needs to determine if the vehicle, building, or immediately involved area is occupied. If occupied, that does not mean the EMS crew automatically enters the area to render aid. Remember, injured or dead EMTs do not help others. It may be necessary to leave a patient in the affected area while the EMS crew remains outside the danger zone. If the hazardous material is leaking from a visible container, the size and shape of the container may provide some clues as to the material being discharged. Bulk containers come in many shapes and sizes, which would indicate a solid or liquid material, while gaseous hazardous materials under pressure are usually shipped in cylindrical tanks. Hazardous materials can also be transported in steel or plastic drums and even cardboard boxes. Placards, if affixed to the container, vehicle, or structure, can also be used as a means to identify a substance. Most vehicles carrying hazardous materials are required to placard the vehicle on all four sides. If the EMT can identify the material from available placards, it is then possible to use the Emergency Response Guidebook to determine initial precautions and isolation distances that should be employed. By law, drivers of hazardous materials need to carry papers showing what they are hauling at all times. If safe access to the vehicle is available, it may be possible to retrieve shipping papers or bills of lading. These papers are an excellent resource because they will contain a list of the materials being transported. If possible, contacting the shipping company directly may also provide some information on the materials being transported. Finally, when approaching the scene, utilize all of your senses as appropriate, not just your eyes. The EMT may hear certain noises, like hissing or small explosions, that could indicate something under pressure. If you smell a product or hazardous material, you may be too close, depending on the chemical involved. Obviously, physical contact or tasting a chemical in an attempt to identify the material is not an acceptable practice. If the dispatcher does not automatically provide it to you, ask for the wind speed and direction when responding to a hazardous materials incident. Gathering this information en route helps you approach from an upwind direction. If possible, also approach from uphill and remain a safe distance away from the scene. It is not unusual to see large crowds gathering around emergency scenes. Most people are inherently curious and are commonly not aware of the hazards to which they may be exposed at such a scene. This exposure to danger is elevated at hazardous materials scenes given the unpredictable nature of hazardous materials and the weather. The less people lingering around the scene, the better. If not already completed by other responders, the EMS crew should establish a perimeter to control the area if possible. Do not hesitate to seek law enforcement assistance in establishing or maintaining the perimeter. Isolating the area also helps other responders understand where the different zones are located. There are typically three zones established for hazardous materials incidents: hot, warm, and cold. The hot zone is, or can be, dangerous. The cold zone is safe. And the warm zone is an area of transition between the two, typically where decontamination occurs. Unless the incident is extraordinarily small, your crew will not have the personnel necessary to establish all three zones. Begin by establishing a threshold for the cold zone and call for additional resources to begin the process of establishing the other zones and mitigating the incident. Unless trained and functioning as part of a hazardous materials mitigation team with appropriate PPE, the EMT should never enter the warm or hot zone. The primary function of an EMS crew at a hazardous materials scene is to triage, treat, and transport patients as they are decontaminated and become available in the cold zone. Follow the directions of the incident commander, as crew integrity and accountability is of vital importance during hazardous materials incidents. It may also be necessary for the EMS crew to provide rehab services for the other personnel on scene. Regardless of the function served by the EMS crew, always ensure contact with hazardous materials is avoided. Do not treat or transport patients or other emergency personnel on scene until they have been decontaminated. Remember, when trained to the awareness level, emergency responders such as yourself are prepared to potentially identify the material from a safe distance and establish a perimeter. Awareness level responders are not to enter the hot zone. Additionally, extensive training along with specialized PPE are required to mitigate a hazardous material scene. So, what do you see in this picture? This looks like a cylindrical rail car, so it could be carrying a liquid or a gas. Does it look discolored? What could that mean? Maybe there is a leak or a rupture. If so, someone needs to determine where the leak or rupture is and how long it has been that way. Try to find out what is in the rail car and how much it can hold. Those who work for the train company may be able to provide important information, so do not hesitate to ask questions. Also, look at the front of this car. Is the placard missing or covered by some substance? Gather as much information as possible while remaining in the cold zone. When addressing hazardous materials incidents, it is not uncommon for the mitigation teams to address environmental concerns as a part of their functions. Spills can happen anywhere, and it is necessary to be conscious of all waterways, sewers, wetlands, and wildlife areas. Hazardous materials contamination can have a devastating impact on the environment, which also includes the people who live in the area. If containment of the material is not possible, problems associated with the spill may continue for quite some time after the event. Some resources available to emergency responders and EMS personnel include local hazardous materials mitigation teams, as well as the DOT Emergency Response Handbook, which should be maintained in every ambulance. The Chemical Transportation Emergency Center, ChemTrec, is another excellent resource available 24 hours a day to offer assistance with contacting the shipper and directing your initial course of action. The EMT trained to the hazardous materials awareness level is sorely unprepared to mitigate hazardous materials incidents. As a result, it is absolutely imperative to call for additional resources as necessary to address these types of incidents. In summary, we should be able to see the need to keep ourselves and the general public safe by setting up a perimeter immediately upon recognizing a hazardous materials spill or leak. The general public does not understand how dangerous some of these scenes may be, so quick action on our part to secure the area is of paramount importance. We can identify different materials or chemicals by container shapes, placards, labels, and paperwork, but only if we can do so from the cold zone. Different resources are available to help us set up an initial perimeter. Anytime we respond to a spill or leak, we need to consider the effects on the environment and also contact the appropriate resources. Hazardous material scenes can seem very overwhelming, but EMS personnel typically do not have to worry about the operations for the entire incident. Rather, there are experts that will come in to mitigate the hazard, and we, as awareness level EMS providers, can assist them by gathering information, being observant, and initially controlling the scene. With this module now completed, you should be able to explain the EMT's role during a call involving hazardous materials. Describe what the EMT should do if there is reason to believe that there is a hazard at the scene. Describe the actions that an EMT should take to ensure bystander safety. State the role the EMT should perform until appropriately trained personnel arrive on scene. Break down the steps to approaching a hazardous material situation, and discuss various environmental hazards that affect EMS. Again, this presentation provided just a very cursory overview of hazardous materials emergency response. Additional training will be required to obtain proficiency in awareness level skills. This presentation was not meant to convey any operations level or higher material. Please contact your instructor with any questions and do not hesitate to pursue additional training if you would like more information on the topic of hazardous materials mitigation. This presentation was created by Waukesha County Technical College with grant funding from the Wisconsin Technical College System.